worship you. You're the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You're the Master of the universe. You're the ruler of all nations. And we sing to you. We sing to you. We sing to you.
Amen. Would you please stand as we join in worship this morning?
Everyone around the world, hear the joyful sound. See the heavens open up, hear the music coming down. Nothing's gonna separate us from the Father's love.
Good morning. Can you hear me? Wait, I got to take my mask off. I forgot the Baylor Bears won this week the national championship, and so I had to say this for my daughter down in Waco. But no, it is awesome to see all of you here. It's great to be in the house of the Lord. I want to welcome all of you. I'm excited that someday when masks can come off completely, that I can see your smiles out there. So I'm going to update a few things going on in the news of the life of the church. And also hi to everyone on, what's it called, Facebook? My daughter's watching in the quarantine hotel this morning, so she can't be at church. So if I mess up, she told me that Pastor John never fired me before. So Brian, there's pressure there. But let's go over a few things going on in the life of the church. Starting today, exciting news that the children's church is returning. Okay, amen. And would want to let all of you know that if you have kids, if you have not signed up, please step out there and sign up for that. That's a way of tracking the kids when they come back in. So, and you will be released in the service later. It's kids ages 4 through 11 or 3 if you are potty trained. Man, these kids potty train quicker, let me tell you. My wife's not, never mind, I won't know. So next Sunday, she'll be here. Next Sunday, the youth have a movie matinee at the Huffman House after the service. Food and snacks will be provided, so next Sunday, youth, be aware of that. Also, the seniors' trip to the Tulip Festival this week, it is sold out, which is good. So every one of you that have signed up, Monday and Friday, please be here by 10 o'clock. Because John says the bus is leaving at 10, so be here. I learned something new this morning. We are doing a church communication poll. And out in the Welcome Center, there is this sheet. And one of the questions is, what are your preferred social medias? I didn't know what a TalkTick was or a Tumblr, but please fill that out for communication for the church so we can communicate as a body the best way for all of you technically advanced things. Another thing, I want to thank all of you again for your tithing and contributions to our church through the last year. Remind you that there is a box out right at the Welcome Center from me to put your tithes and offerings in, or online, again, at lynchwood.org, I believe that is. Also, May 2nd, we are having a Cinco de Mayo lunch after service. It'll be a sit-down lunch in the gym. You're all invited. Those of you that can't make it or don't want to participate in that part, there are take-home lunches if you respond by 4:29. So thank you very much for tolerating me. At this time, Patty is going to come up and discuss our missions moments.
Morning. Christian persecution is higher today than at any other time in modern history. And according to the stats by Open Doors, there's over 340 million Christians living in places where they experience high levels of persecution and discrimination just for following Jesus. That's 1 in 8 believers throughout the world. As I was studying this world map and praying over these nations, it just impressed upon me how many of these countries the Church of God is in and has churches and are ministering, and also Children of Promise programs where children are being cared for and nurtured in the church in several of these countries. Go to slide 2. So I have the map of Children of Promise. Kind of, that's, you know, what struck me is looking at the countries where Children of Promise is involved, just how important it is as we sponsor children and help them to, be given hope and a hope for a future in these countries. That just struck me. Children of Promise programs for those of you that aren't familiar, Children of Promise is a Church of God child sponsorship program. And God continues to just call up leaders and work with churches and create thriving, healthy churches in all these areas throughout the world. Children of Promise programs are mostly administered in countries by volunteers associated with churches, so it's not by paid people. To bring these children in. They're people that just love on these children and their families. We'll go ahead to the next one. Children of Promise is just kicking off a campaign for the next 2 weeks. Today's the first day of the campaign. And there are over 4,500 children sponsored in 30 countries around the world. And so you can go ahead to the next one. The campaign that's kicking off is I had another slide in here first. The way that Children of Promise works is they provide food for families and are supporting nutritional needs, providing school fees and uniforms for children to go to school, healthcare needs, basic hygiene needs, as well as discipleship and encouraging children to know and accept Jesus as their Savior. So it's that four-prong approach in the Children of Promise program. So this today they're kicking off a program, and the goals are to have additional 100 children supported and sponsored by the end of the month. And because there are several children that have been listed needing sponsors for quite some time, and sometimes sponsors are in situations where they're not able to continue their sponsorship, or there's additional needs that the child might have, a new fund has been created called a GAP fund. And this fund will help children who've been in those situations where they're waiting a sponsor or lost their sponsor, or have a desire to go to school beyond their high school where their sponsorship ends. But often these are trade schools, so children have been able to go to get mechanical training or sewing training or some additional things that they can then get work beyond their school education. So just wanted to make you aware of the fund that's kicking off. And if you want more information about that, I'll be at the Welcome Center after the service. You can go ahead to the next slide. Pastor Brian and I have been talking recently about the persecuted church, and we are planning on offering a movie night, a video night here at the church, and it'll be like the third week in May. And be watching for more information about the dates on that. But Nick and Ruth Ripken have worked with the persecuted church for a number of years, and this is a documentary movie of their life and testimony and the interviews and work that they've done with areas around the world that are in this high persecution for believing in Christ. And so we just want you to think about setting aside the time to pray and to come and hear more about those that are suffering because of their faith in Christ. And if you go to the next slide, my prayer that's on my heart this morning is that you would be in prayer for the children around the world who are experiencing hope because someone invested in their lives and is providing sponsorship for them, that they're able to attend school, that they're able to receive basic food and hygiene needs, and most importantly, to hear the good news of Jesus Christ. And also continue to be in prayer for Christians around the world who experience personal risk, just living their life of faith. And because they know that living for Jesus, because he is the way, he is the truth, he is the life, and living your life for Jesus is worth it, no matter where in the world that you live your life in your faith. So thank you for your continued support for missions, and come back and learn a little bit more about the persecuted church. Thanks.
Thank you, Patty, for your leadership with our missions team there. At this time, if you are able, I would encourage you to stand for opening prayer, remain standing for scripture reading, and worship through song. So, Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this day, for you have made it, Lord. We thank you for the beautiful weather, and we just thank you for the opportunity that us as a group can come together and worship you in this service, Father. I just pray that your Holy Spirit will envelop us in this service, Lord. And we will speak in spirit and truth. Lord, I ask a special blessing on our pastor as he continues to deliver the words that we need to hear, Lord. And we will give you the praise and the honor and glory. In your name we pray. Amen.
Morning. Today's scripture reading comes from Colossians 3:12-17. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, and as you sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs with gratitude in your hearts to God. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and Father through him.
Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive us again. We praise thee, O God, for the Son. Jesus, who died and is now God above.
From wherever you've been, and come brokenhearted, let rescue begin, and come find your mercy, O sinner, come near. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burden. Oh,
no sorrow that heaven can't take.
Blessing to be in God's house, amen. Be part of the family of God. All you that are in the crow's nest up there, glad you're here too. You know, we sing a song, Daniel, and I really like it. Victory belongs to Jesus. You know, I like the Beavers and I like the Ducks, Jim, and I like Baylor, but victory is the Lord's. And we come as winners today because we know the Lord and we serve him. You know, in our family, we have prayer concerns, and I just want to share a few with you this morning. A praise this morning. Mark and Tracy's daughter, Alicia, has accepted a job to work at NASA in Alabama. Let's congratulate her and Mark and Tracy. What a blessing. And in the way of new concerns, Roger's going to have some surgery, and I would appreciate prayer. Mike Henry is in Veterans Hospital, undergoing many difficult health concerns. Annie Haynes, we got the report this week that she has cancer on the spine, and so we want to really lift her up. I know she's got a beautiful attitude. Donna Helmus has got an infection that needs to clear up before she can have her ankle fused. Donna, our prayers are with you this morning. Jamie Getz needs a stent or a bypass. And this morning, I know Renee Myers would appreciate prayers for her mother who had a stroke or has a broken pelvis. I'm sorry, broken pelvis. Linda King, leg pain. There's so many concerns. Maybe there's something on your heart. Maybe by an uplifted hand said, Lord, I got something I want to bring to you. And the Lord does hear and answer prayer. Let's bow our heads and spend a few moments thanking him, praising him, and petitioning him, and I'll lead us in a public prayer. Father, we're grateful that victory belongs to Jesus, that we're on the winning side with Jesus. Though hot may be the fray, my soul could only say, I'm on the winning side with Jesus, and we serve a great God, a God who loved us so much that we just celebrated your resurrection, that we serve a living God who's in the world today, is in our hearts today. He's moving, he's changing lives, he's healing, he's bringing hope. And that's why this morning we can come before you with our praises, our gratitude, our thanksgiving for all you have done and for all that you're doing. And Lord, we want to lift up some of these folks this morning. Pray that Roger's surgery goes well, for Mike, who is battling so many things, Mike Henry, for Annie, who we love her dearly. Just, Lord, be with her especially, and we'd ask that you'd even remove this cancer on her spine. For Donna, pray that she'll get a good report so she can go ahead with her surgery. We pray for Jamie this morning, who loves you, and Darlene, Lord, be with him as he awaits this coming surgery. And Lord, for the challenges that come to the Meyer family, they love their mom. Pray that you'll just minister to her and through her daughters. For Linda King, faithful servant of yours, bless her, Lord. And Lord, for the prayer concerns that are lifted in this room this morning, that are lifted from those that are watching at home, Lord, give us faith as a grain of mustard seed, that we can literally say to this mountain, be moved to the sea, and it'll happen. Lord, you told us to knock and to seek and to ask, and this morning we're knocking, we're seeking, we're asking, And we're thanking you in advance for what you can do, for what you will do, and for what you have done. Again, we pray for Pastor Brian. Bless the word this morning. Give us ears to hear. Give us hearts to respond. And Lord, help us to remember, we serve a risen Savior. In Jesus' name, amen.
If you're able, would you please stand as we worship and respond?
I want to be close, close to your side, so heaven is real and death is a lie. I want to hear voices of angels above, singing as one, hallelujah. Holy, holy, God Almighty, the great I am, who is worthy, one beside thee, God Almighty, the great I am. I want to be near, near to your heart, loving the world, hating the dark. I want to see dry.
Great. Jesus is the victor. Jesus is the victor. Open your Bibles this morning with me. I'll take that one. Let's turn to Romans 12. Romans 12, 9. We'll read through the end of the chapter here. That page turning is a beautiful sound. It says, let love be without hypocrisy. Abhor what is evil, but cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in a brotherly love. Give preference to one another in honor, not lagging behind in diligence. Be fervent in prayer, serving the Lord. Rejoicing in hope, persevering through tribulation, devoted to prayer, and contributing to the needs of the saints and practicing hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless, do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. Be of the same mind towards one another. Do not be haughty in mind, but associate with the lowly. Do not be wise in your own estimation. Never pay back evil to anyone. Respect what is right in the sight of all men. And if possible, so far as it depends on you, be at peace with all men. So never take your own revenge, beloved, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written that vengeance is mine and I will repay, says the Lord. But if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him drink. For in doing so, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Lord, we're dealing with an immense subject matter this morning, one that we possibly couldn't even begin to barely scratch the surface of. But Father, as we do dive into it, we ask that where we begin to scratch, it would be a place that itches. And that each one of us would be challenged today to pick up our cross, to not repay evil for evil, to not be overcome by evil, but to teach us, Lord, in a very practical sense, what it means to overcome evil with good. In Jesus' name, amen. Before I begin today, I have to issue a public apology. It was made known to me last week that I said something that was untrue. And so I need to correct that mistake. Sometimes when you go off your notes and you start getting into jive of things and you start quoting Disney characters, you quote the wrong one. And I said that Timon said that the stars were balls of gas burning billions of miles away in the Lion King, when in fact Timon is the meerkat and the pig Pumbaa was the one that said it. My apologies. I hope you all forgive me. I think there was something else, but I don't remember what it was, so. Just want to set the record straight. Yeah. Yes. Am I supposed to let the children out? Well, children, now that you've had your apology, you can leave. I believe they're meeting out here in the hall, so if children have not been dismissed yet, please do so. So, well, turn with me this morning to Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5, verse 9. Jesus says, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. Anybody ever heard of the name Telemachus? Telemachus. Now, you're probably thinking Telemachus, he's that Greek guy, right? Because there's a Greek mythology, you know, the son of Odysseus and Penelope. No, the saint, I can't pronounce it no matter how many times I say it, Telemachus, you're just going to have to bear with me. It's, you know, it just rolls off the tongue, right? The guy, Timilicus. He was a monk in a monastery at about the 4th century. And history records that at a certain time he left his monastery and he went into Rome. And as he went into Rome, he was drawn into this sports arena. And as the gladiators came out for their competition and the crowds were cheering, he understood what was about to take place, that they were cheering in a battle that was going to leave one or more of them lifeless. And just being driven by the compulsion of the love of Christ, he goes down, he jumps over the barrier, he gets in the middle of this arena between these two gladiators, and he begins to scream to the crowd, in the name of Jesus, this must stop. In the name of Christ, this must stop. Of course, you can imagine what you would feel like if your football game was interrupted by someone that was saying, oh, it's too violent. Different time, different culture, probably the same thing. And so the crowd was upset, and they were taunting and chanting, and that just determined him all the more. He began to shout, in the name of Jesus, this must stop, this must stop. As history records, there's actually two records of what potentially happened to him. One was, at the crowd's request, one of the gladiators pulled his sword and right in the middle of the arena thrust the sword right through his back and through his chest. The other that was that the crowd was so upset and dismayed, they took him out and they stoned him to death. In either case, it does record that he was martyred for his public defiance of the gladiator sport. And the Christian writer, the historian Theodoret, he wrote that it was the martyrdom of this saint that led the emperor at the time, in time, to have this change of heart where, because of the sacrifice, because he saw for the first time the pain and the agony, the suffering, the brutality of these games, it was this cry, this plea that cost him his life that moved the emperor to ban these gladiator games in Rome and throughout the kingdom. He literally gave his life for the peace of others, so that others, gladiators who are slaves, can live. Now, what comes to mind when you think, blessed are the peacemakers? It says, for they shall be the sons of God. And this term, the sons of God, that doesn't mean you're going to be Jesus. Okay, it doesn't really have anything to do so much with your genealogy or your status. This was actually a common phrase of the time that defined your characteristic. Jesus himself named two of his disciples sons of thunder. Well, they were the sons of Zebedee. What? Their dad's name wasn't thunder. No, it was describing a character. It was describing an attribute. These are the two men, John and James, who when they went into Samaria, they said, hey, Jesus, you want us to pray down fire on them? Jesus says, you don't know what heart you have, you sons of thunder. Jesus says, the peacemakers shall be called the sons of God. What's he saying? He's saying that the peacemakers in society, that people are going to recognize them and begin to call them out as being godly, as being godlike. There's something, not that they are divine, but there's something pure and beautiful in their nature that you can see God through the peacemakers. And even in this story, irregardless of how history records it, we see a man who gives his life for the peace, for the life of somebody else. And what do we see? We see the image of Christ come forth. Blessed are the peacemakers, or oh, the happiness of God's favor, as we've discussed, that is upon those who make peace, for people will recognize them as being godly, as being sons of God. What comes to mind when you hear the word peacemaker? You know, I've mentioned in the past that in college we had two of my favorite classes were New Testament literature and Old Testament literature. Most practical classes I took, we just did a deep dive into the Bible, and we went book by book. And we had to outline it, and then we had to, you know, who wrote it, when it was written, who it was written for, and what the purpose was, and what are the themes of the book, and what's distinctive about this book, and how it was put together, all these things. Like, we just did this huge deep dive, And when you go through that for 2 years straight, you get pretty familiar with the scriptures, which is great. And my professor at the time who led us through that, anytime we'd do one book at a time, when we get to the end of the book, he would say, now what key word or phrase sums that up for you? And, you know, so we would, you know, some of them were easy, like Leviticus, we'd say law, right? Or in 2 Samuel, the story of David. Nehemiah, the wall. You look at Jeremiah, suffering servant. Or Matthew, the gospel to the Jews, whereas Luke was more of a gospel to the Gentiles. But you have these short phrases or these words, and what he was trying to do is he was trying to give us this little theme, but in that little theme, everything that we would just learn would fall under the banner. You think about a title of a book, right? You know, if you read the title of a book, suddenly you know everything that's in there. It's kind of this suitcase that you open, and all the contents spill out. And that's what he was trying to do. He was trying to get us to summarize these books in something so small that when we heard that word or that phrase, that it would unlock it for us. And so we would know where things were and how things were put together and it was written. And little did I know at the time, and my guess is it was intentional, but I can't say that it was because I never asked him. But he was using a teaching technique that the rabbis of Jesus' day would use. And it is this form of teaching where you teach about something at length, or you teach about it often, you teach about it in great detail, and then you just wrap it up in a single sentence. You put it in this suitcase, you put a bow on it, and then people learn to compartmentalize and see the connection. And this is the way that Jesus taught. This is the way that these Beatitudes were, is that these Beatitudes were not something that Jesus just mentioned once and moved on. These were something that Jesus probably mentioned again and again and again throughout his ministry as he taught people about the fullness of these things. See, we think, oh man, these statements of Jesus, they're so vague and they're kind of hard to really understand the fullness of it. But these were something that would unlock so many elements of how Jesus lived and how Jesus taught, right? And so I can just imagine, of course we don't have records so I don't know, but I can just imagine this woman anointing Jesus' feet and wiping his feet with her hair, and Jesus turning to his disciples and saying, blessed are the poor in spirit. There you go. It fits into that category. You see that? I just learned a piece of that. I can see Jesus healing a leper and turning to them and saying, blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. As Lazarus came forth out of the tomb, going to Mary and to Martha and saying, remember, blessed are those who mourn. Things would have come up again. They were categories that Jesus could continue to put things in and under, kind of like this filing cabinet in their brain. So that at the end of Jesus' ministry, it's not that they just had a sentence, blessed are the peacemakers. But they had all these life experiences that now were unpacked by this simple statement of Christ. He put them all in there. And so what we have here is this suitcase full, where the disciples would have understood that when Jesus said, blessed are the peacemakers, all of these teachings, all of these incidents, all of these actions of Jesus would have begun to fill their minds with what that means. As I sat down this week and looked at this statement, blessed are the peacemakers, I began to really wrestle with just how big of a suitcase that is. How big of a suitcase is peace? And you all know this because you guys have all watched a Miss America pageant, right? What would you like to see happen in the world? World peace. And you're like, ha, what do you even mean by that? Because we instinctively know that though you can say that sentence, it's so diverse, it's so complex, it happens on so many different levels. Like, how are you going to accomplish that? Love. Like, great. Real true world leader right there, just going to make it all so easy. But we know peace isn't that easy. If it was, we'd have it done by now because we're just that smart. Well, what does it mean to make peace? How do you make peace? And you're like, well, Brian, it depends. Well, of course it depends. How do you make peace with a store that won't take back your defective goods? How do you make peace with an officer who gave you a ticket you know you didn't deserve? How do you make peace with a contractor who didn't do his or her job correctly? How do you make peace with a neighbor who has a dog that won't stop barking? These are all different. They all are just so intricate and deep. Even when I say that, you say, well, it depends. You're right, it does depend. How do you make peace with an employer who uses you, or in Jesus' day, a slave master who abused his slaves? How do you make peace with a governmental system that's oppressive? What was Patty talking about earlier? How does one government make peace with another government when the other government desires war? You see, because what we're dealing with in the world is, it's not like everybody's repentant and good-hearted and wants to get along. Have you found that out yet? Not everybody wants to get along. How do you make peace with this? How do you make peace in a growing divide of political ideologies in our own day and age? How do you make peace in a place of racial tension and cultural and ethical tension in an increasingly diverse world? How do you make peace for those living in poverty, or peace with a health condition that threatens or changes your life or someone else's? How do you make peace with the loss of a loved one? How do you make peace with a family member who is abusive, or a child who is rebellious and unrepentantly so? How do you make peace with a spouse that has hurt you or betrayed you, betrayed your trust? How do you make peace with yourself when you know that you have made decisions that have unbearable consequences that you can't take anymore? And how do you make peace with God when he has allowed things to happen in your life that you can't imagine why, or when you think that you've drifted so far that he would never take you back? How do you make peace? You see, we understand that this is just huge, and I can just imagine Jesus quoting this passage, this statement again and again as he just walks through life, as he touches someone, as he heals someone, as he reaches out, as he shares the parable, to turn to his disciples and just say, remember the suitcase, blessed are the peacemakers. As he walks through life, encountering conflict after conflict after conflict, yet leaning into peace. We know that this is just a huge and complex subject that touches every aspect of our lives. And if this statement reveals anything to us, it reveals just how powerless we feel to create peace in a world gone mad. Because we realize just how big it is. When Jesus approached Jerusalem, before he even came in, riding on the donkey on Palm Sunday, it says he stopped and he looked over Jerusalem. This is in Luke chapter 19. It says, as he approached Jerusalem, he saw the city and he began to weep over the city, saying, if you had known this day, even you, the things which made for peace, but they've been hidden from you. And we feel that way too. If we only knew the things which made for peace. And we know the world desperately needs peacemakers. We desperately need peacemakers, but these things of peace, it seems like they've just been hidden from us. The words of the old Christmas carol, and in despair I bow my head, there is no peace on earth, I said, for hate is strong and mocks the song of peace on earth, goodwill to men. I think every one of us has, maybe we haven't had that echo in those words particularly, but we've had that echo through us. It's like there's just so much division and there's so much conflict in this world. This whole idea of peace just seems ridiculous. It seems a journey far-fetched. It gives us, almost brings us to hopelessness because it's just so big. There's a old pastoral illustration that I'm sure you've heard, but it bears repeating, of a young man who's walking on the beach. And as he's walking along the beach, these starfish have have come up. Yeah, you guys have heard it, right? But the starfish have come on the beach, and they're sitting there, and they're slowly dying because they're no longer in the water. And so he picks one up and throws it back into the water. And he picks another one up, and he throws it back into the water. And this old wise man came up, and he said, "What are you doing, wasting your time with all these starfish? Don't you see there's so many out there, you'll never make a difference?" And the young man just looks at him, and he bends over, and he picks up, and he throws another one in, and he looks back at him and says, "I made a difference for that one." The world is big, and we're small, but everybody's got a starfish. Everybody has the ability to make a difference. And so what I want to do this morning, like I said, this subject is, it's so massive. And I'm not going to keep you here till next Thursday. So this subject is so massive that what I want to do this morning is really give you something practical that you can begin to apply today. That is probably something that I think is really going to scratch where we itch. And just give you a couple aspects of it. And these are places in Jesus' life where I but wonder if Jesus either said or the apostles remembered this statement, "Blessed are the peacemakers." Times in his life when those things would have been unpacked for him. And these are things that the Lord is teaching and working on with me, so congratulations, you get to walk a little day in my shoes. But just two things this morning, because I think that's enough. Any more than that, we'll probably begin to slip it. But turn with me to John's Gospel, John chapter 15. John chapter 15, verse 18 and 19. Jesus says, "If the world hates me," well, we'll read a little further. "If the world hates me, you know that it hated me first. If you are of the world would love its own. But because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, because of this the world hates you. Remember the word that I said to you, a slave is not greater than his master. And if they have persecuted me, they will persecute you. If you keep my word, they will keep yours. If you keep my word, they will keep yours also. But all these things they will do to you for my name's sake, because they do not know the one who sent me." So Jesus says to his disciples, "Now look, they're going to hate you, but I need you to remember this when they hate you. They hated me first." Why is that so important for Jesus to mention? What's he saying in this? Jesus understood and he knew that as his disciples were not of this world, that they were going to be sharing some things that not everybody was going to be real thrilled with. Fair? And people were going to respond in a way that wasn't very kind. From small to great, you know, maybe they would lie about them as they lied about Jesus. Perhaps they would be slandered about, maybe they'd be misrepresented. Oftentimes they would return harm for good. In our current climate, right? Maybe you'd be Facebook stalked, maybe you'd be trolled, maybe you'd be censored, whatever it is. Maybe you would even lose your job. And all of this would happen while these men were operating out of a pure heart. So they were trying to do something good, but evil was returned for that good. Now let me ask you a very honest question. See, because this happened to Jesus all the time. Jesus would heal a man of a disease, a lifelong disease, and people would get angry at him for it. Have you ever, in a good heart, really tried to do something nice, and someone responded evil for kind? How does that sit with you? "Oh, it's just fine, Brian. I turn the other cheek, and I praise the Lord, and I move on with my day." Liars! Okay? You don't. Here's the deal. Unless you're just a wonderful person, I'd like to shake your hand. I try, but you know what? When I give my best, we see this with, never mind. Anyway, but when I try to give my all and do something that I really feel is going to bless somebody, and then their first remark is something evil back, I take it personally. Y'all do that? No, just me? Well, bear with me. We'll be done in a little while, okay? Look, follow me here. This is so important. Is it feels like an attack. It feels like an offensive coming against me. One more step. I feel offended. I feel offended. What happens when an attack comes against you? When an offensive comes against you, what is your natural response, sports fans? You become defensive. When you feel offended, you become defensive. Let me ask you this, and we're going to flesh this out a little bit, but look, what happens to your heart when you get offended? How much room does the Holy Spirit have to operate when you have the spirit of offense within you? How well do we listen when we are offended? Earlier, Rose read a scripture. It said to clothe ourselves with compassion and kindness and humility and gentleness and patience out of Colossians 3. How well do you do those things when you're offended? Oh, I'm fantastic at those. That's when I excel the most. Look, why is Jesus saying, look, they hated me first? He's because he doesn't want them to operate out of an offended spirit. So he says, when they respond to the way that you act, the way that you behave, the way that you give in love, I want you to ascribe that offense to me because I don't want you to act offended. Because when you begin to act offended, when your spirit becomes offended, you begin to shut down the Holy Spirit in your life. You have a combative heart, and the Spirit of God can no longer begin to work through you. A couple months ago, a very good friend of mine sent me an email to read. We had a little lunch date set up. And he said, hey, read this before you come over. It's an interesting article. And so I begin to read this article, and I'm about two or three paragraphs in, and I'm just hot. Okay? The word's triggered. Fair? And this... It's a lengthy article, and I'm only a couple in, and I'm already arguing with the author of just how ignorant he is when he's trying to write some piece about how the church has become dumb, right? And so I get to the end of it, and I step back from it, and I'm like, okay, how much past paragraph two did you get? And I'm just going to be honest with you, I put it away. And later I came back. And I said, Lord, the last time I read this, I was offended. Help me not to be offended. Help me read past this so that I can see what this man is saying. And I had to begin, it took me several reads. I'm going to be honest with you. It took me several reads. I had to crucify that offended spirit because that offended spirit was blocking me from hearing what I needed to learn from it. Because I immediately jumped out and was defensive. And as I worked through that process, right, of being able to hear and to respond, ultimately, there were things that I learned. But even more than that, I was able to have an awesome conversation with my friends about that. But if I had just been offended and responded in that offense, I'm here to tell you, look, there would have been nothing but combat in our conversation. There would have been no peace. There would have been no unity. There would have been no move of the Holy Spirit. We have to let Jesus crucify the offended spirit within us. We read earlier Romans 12. Why do you think Paul says leave room for the wrath of God? So far as it depends on you, be at peace. We have to begin to let those things go. Sheila and I were talking a couple days ago. Whether you feel this way or not, I'm just going to be candid with you, and this is how I feel. Okay? The world, as we know it, has become impossible to live in because there's too many rules. Everybody has all of these rules, whether they be written or whether they be unwritten, and if you break any of them, you're guilty of high treason. I used to feel like I could walk up to anybody and say, hi, how are you doing? And now I'm like, uh-oh, will I say the wrong thing? Did I look the wrong way? Did I judge? What'd I do? And this world, I've been completely crippled My kindness has been completely crippled because if I don't behave, if I don't do the right thing, if I don't say the right thing, if I don't address someone the right way, it's over for me. Because what? Because I have offended them. And these rules have just become so binding. You know, I don't have mine on me, sit down in my seat. One of the ones that we can all do is the masks, right? It doesn't matter what you do with the mask, you're going to offend somebody. You know, either if I say, please put on a mask, I am offending you because I am trampling on your rights. If I take mine off, you're going to kill me and the whole village. But it's, you guys know, right? There's no win. And we have literally, hear me now, churches are dividing over this stuff. They're so angry and they're so offended on both sides. Because why? They're responding out of what they feel is attack against them rather than what is right. They're not hearing one another. They're responding out of an offensive spirit. We're offended over so many things. We're offended over being misrepresented. We're offended over being taken advantage of or misunderstood or undervalued. If we feel insignificant or not heard, if people speak wrongfully of us or slander us, some of us are offended when people call us out or if we're called to repent. We're offended if someone disagrees with us. This is an important statement, especially for those of you that are already offended that I'm talking about how people are offended. Take a chill pill. I don't bring this up to condemn the world. I bring this up to call the church out. I bring this up to call the church out. Let's step out of being offended over everything. We cannot function this way. And if you guys think it's just the other guys, look again, it's you. We all have these triggers that set us off. That's being offended. That's being offended. But the offended spirit is like backing a cat into a corner. I've never had a good experience with this. No good response comes from an offended spirit, and no peace comes from the offended spirit. The peace comes from the Holy Spirit. And Jesus here is saying, look, if they hate you, if they persecute you, if you're intending good and they respond in evil, you know what? Credit it to me. Stop being offended. It's mine to deal with, not yours. Love them. And so my challenge for you this week, number one, is we have to begin to recognize when we're responding out of offense or when we're responding out of love. And if we're offended, we need to take a step back. We need to take a step back and really look at our own hearts. Because if we are, the Spirit of God is not going to move. I'll speed up here, I promise. Let's turn again now over to Matthew's Gospel. We'll do one more here, and this one will be somewhat brief, but very, very much tied in. Again, we're not even scratching the surface, but I hope that there's a couple things here that are practical for you that really hit where we're at today in our society. Matthew chapter 10, 11 and 12. Jesus is sending out the disciples to go minister here, okay? And he says to them as a part of their instructions, he says, whatever city or village you enter, inquire who is worthy in it, and stay at that house until you leave that city. Now, as you enter that house, it says, give it your greeting, and if the house is worthy, give it your blessing of peace. And if it is not worthy, take back your blessing of peace. Whoever does not receive you nor heed your words, as you go out, you shall shake the dust off your feet. Jesus has this very weird statement of, when you come into a house, place a blessing of peace upon it, and if they don't respond in kind, I want you to take that blessing of peace and I want you to move on. What in the world is Jesus talking about? Is it like a flower bouquet that says peace on it? It's like, here, you can have my peace. You're not good enough. I'll take it to the next house. Thank you very much. You know, as Jesus says again, and it's very similar in theme, as you go from house to house, you're going to find those that treat you well. You're going to find those that receive your message. You're going to find those that you have unity and camaraderie with, and they're filled with joy, and you're filled with joy because of your meeting, but you're also going to have much pain and sorrow because there are going to be people that you invest in, people that you love, people that you give to who do not return in kind. Have you ever walked into a conversation feeling very much at peace and walked out feeling very much not at peace? I believe this is exactly what Jesus is talking about. Is there's going to be times in which you go to a home to minister and you think you're going to be well received. And you bring your peace. You bring the fact that you are centered, that you're in the right frame of mind. You come with a pure heart, and something's going to happen in that interaction that's going to completely change your pure heart. It's going to begin to rip at you and prod at you, and you're going to get all twisted up. You're going to get angry. You're going to get bitter. You're going to get dejected, right? And you're going to get discouraged. And Jesus says, in that situation, what I don't want you to do, I don't want you to leave your peace behind. I need you to take it with you. And I need you to go someplace else in peace. Because if you don't take up your peace, if you don't reclaim your peace before you go to the next house, you are going to be taking your hurt and your pain and everything that they did, and you're going to begin to treat them and their situation based on what happened here rather than what's the need of the moment. Pick up your peace. Reclaim your peace. When I was in high school, we had an assembly, and it was made to put the fear of God in us, and for some it did, which was really good, where we were out in the football field, and all of a sudden these blankets were ripped off, and there was wrecked cars, and all of our friends were laying with fake blood on them, right? And the EMTs and everybody show up, and they go through this whole thing. It was before prom, drinking and driving kind of threat, which was good, needed to happen. And our friends were put in body bags and taken away and weren't there the rest of the day. And one of the things that I remember vividly is the EMTs getting to the scene and just walking around. It's like, this is an emergency, move it! And they didn't. One first responder that I know pretty well has told me, he said, I remember when I go to these things, it's not my emergency, it's theirs. And they told us very specifically, he says, they will not rush because they do not want to miss anything. And they will take their time. In other words, they have to minister from a place of a clear mind and peace. Otherwise, they're going to make the situation worse. And that's the same thing that happens to us as we store up this pain, we store up the rejection, we store up the hurt, and we begin to, here's my point for the second one, is that rather than treating people as people and as individuals with their own story and their own life, we treat them as categories, we treat them as topics, we treat them as this or that or those or them. And what Jesus is saying is every home you enter into, take with it your peace. Otherwise, you won't see them for who they are, and you won't minister to them where they need to be ministered to. Because you're going to be responding to the hurt you had last time rather than this time. Pick up your peace and take it to the next house, because we don't get to go to the next house until we reclaim our peace. Jesus said, blessed are the peacemakers. Daniel, you can come. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. And again, this is this massive topic, but as I think about where we're at in our society, as I think about, I'm never on Facebook, but what I hear of and sometimes see in the dynamics of social media interaction, what I know is happening in homes, what I know is happening in our own city and across this country, I do know this, that we got to pick up a starfish. And we might not be able to change anything, but we got to pick up a starfish. And if we can have the humility with one another, Paul says, as far as it depends on you, this means at your coffee date, this means in your own house, this means at your own workplace, this isn't write your senator kind of stuff, okay? This is, as far as it depends on me, I'm going to pick up my cross. I'm going to crucify that offended spirit, because it's It's hindering me from responding in love, and it's making me respond in defense of myself. And I want to treat every single person as a gift from God, with their own story, with their own life, with their own needs. They're not of those, they're not of them, they're not of that. It's a person. And again, going back to Colossians chapter 3, it says we are to put on love, which is the perfect bond of unity. What does it look like in our lives to surrender as Christ did? Now, I want to tell you, look, if Jesus had approached me or even his disciples with the offended spirit or treating them as those in them, well, one, there would have been no Nicodemus because Nicodemus was a Pharisee. He was the them. There would have been no Peter because Peter offended him a lot. Probably would have been no James and no John. There certainly would have been no Paul. Blessed are the peacemakers. Blessed are the peacemakers. Because when we can begin to make peace, people will begin to see him in us. Would you stand? Lord, we are living in a day when we desperately need peacemakers. And many times we think we're solving the problem. And probably Jesus is weeping over us the same he wept over Jerusalem. If only you knew the things which made for peace. We recognize, Lord, that this is something that we could talk about for the rest of our lives, and we should be. But today, Lord, we just come with two simple requests. That you would teach us the love that puts on the cross the offended spirit. And that you would teach us the love that doesn't see they, them, and those. But sees your children, people that you love, and people that you died for. Each with a story. Each with value in your kingdom and in this world. Amen.
My Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. For thee all the follies of sin I resign. My gracious Redeemer, my Savior,
I love thee for wearing thy
bow your heads. I think one of the most powerful unwritten scenes in the Bible is what happened in the 40 days between resurrection and Pentecost. Because even though Jesus had rose from the dead, these disciples had witnessed the man that they loved be brutally beaten to death, mercilessly. And when the day of Pentecost came, the call was there in Jerusalem to preach the salvation message to the very same people that ripped the flesh off his back and put nails through his hand. The same people who chanted, "Crucify him, crucify him." And the fact that Jesus was raised from the dead did not nullify what they had witnessed and what they had done to him. Something happened in that season where there was a healing in them that allowed them to love without an offended spirit. And the gospel went forward in power because they loved the last ones that the world said that they should have loved. They loved them first. But there was a healing that needed to take place. And I know in this room there are many of us who are hurting. Oftentimes because, let's say it, because of his those and maybe a them or a that. Maybe it's a this or a that. I want to pray for you. Father, we bring our hurts and our offenses to the cross of Calvary. Lord, I pray for a divine healing in mind and in spirit for those who in the midst of whatever situation, be it in their home, all the way out, Lord, even to the public sphere and the political sphere. Father, for many who are so twisted that it's become so easy to be triggered or to be offended, and we can't defeat this on our own. And so, Father, I ask that the same thing that you did in the disciples, as you purified their hearts, that you would purify ours. Purify us again toward our neighbors and our friends and our family. Give us this love of Jesus Christ for each life and for each person. Teach us to listen with new ears and to respond with a new heart. Lord, we know hurting people hurt people, so I ask, Lord, that a divine touch of healing would be upon the hearts that are hurting today. That they would be able to minister peace, Lord, because even in this moment, Lord, you are reconciling peace within them. Transform us to be a peace-making force in this world, Jesus. And it starts at our own dinner table, our own workplace, and our own church. Blessed are the peacemakers. May the world look at us, as Jesus said, so that you will know, they will know you're my disciples by your love for one another. So it's to this end we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Love you guys. You're dismissed. Make sure to not forget your children.